All right, welcome to this video lesson that is going to be the first part of circular motion. We will take a look at circular motion in three parts. We will start with the velocity component, then we'll look at the acceleration, and then we'll look at the forces, all of which are going to dictate how we can both describe what is happening as well as describe why it is happening. First thing to look at though is an example, right? It's always good to be able to see what we're looking at. So this video, and I'll just show a brief little snippet of it, it's going to show the hammer throw, which is an Olympic event that we do not run in Minnesota track and field at the high school level. It is a collegiate event, it's an international event, and it is an Olympic event that you can see. It's very interesting, so I just want you guys to watch it, observe it, and see what it looks like.
It is time for the women's hammer final here at the Olympic Stadium in Rio de Janeiro.
Now we'll get a look at the hot favourite once again. This is her second time in the cage. It was with her second throw winning her first world championship in 2009 that she injured her left ankle and needed surgery while celebrating. So she doesn't mind getting it out there, and she's done it again. She knew on release that this was big. It's beyond 80 again. She's the only woman in the world to do it. She's done it three now, four times. Is she en route to a world record here? That might be the gold right there for Ladacek of Poland.
Well, this looks like it's the gold medal throw of nothing else. Just under a world record, I think. It's over 80 meters, but is it 81? Maybe not, but gee, in fact, you can see the world record there. Yeah. She's about a half a meter underneath the world record.
So we see the event itself. She starts in the back of the circle. There's a good look at it where you can have this metal ball attached to this chain with which the hammer thrower is going to hold. And through her rotating, we can see the circle that is mapped out. Now, the best way to throw this is going to be at a slight angle. So it's not a perfectly horizontal circle. It's not a perfectly vertical circle. It's somewhere in between. And that release point, if you watch when she lets it go, right there, if you track where it's at, she releases it when the hammer is over here, right? And that's based on how we're able to get these velocities and how we're able to see which direction the object is moving in circular motion, and when you release it, where it goes. Because she's rotating counterclockwise as we're looking at the video here, so it rotates, it rotates, it rotates, and then she releases it at what would be 3 o'clock if we're looking at an analog clock. And she releases it at 3 o'clock because that is when the velocity is pointing downrange, which is a very important piece about how we describe our velocities in circular motion here. So here is an example, right? A diagram that's going to show you what direction the velocity is going with respect to the circle. So our velocity, we're measuring this in meters per second, so that's going to stay the same, and we're still looking at this as a vector quantity. But it is moving in a straight line. It is moving linear. It is moving tangent to the circle. Thus why we refer to the velocity of any object in circular motion, we refer to it as a tangential velocity. We'll also write it as a linear velocity because remember, a tangent is a line. So this is a line that is tangent to the circle, thus it is tangential. So as it rotates, so here, based on that velocity vector, we would say that this object is rotating counterclockwise because the vector arrow itself is pointing more to the left, so we'd be able to determine that direction of rotation. And as it spins faster, obviously that velocity is going to increase, and as it spins slower, that velocity is going to decrease. So we get a rotating motion, but the rationale behind why it is tangential for a velocity is if the force that is pulling on that object releases, the object is going to fly off in a straight line, just like we saw with the hammer thrower. So anytime there is a force that is causing something to move in a circular motion, the velocity is always going to be pointing in a straight line at every single instant, which means its velocity is constantly changing because the direction is constantly changing. Here's another example of how this looks. Thank you.
This is a great demonstration for showing that if something's moving in a circle and you remove the centripetal force, it'll move in a straight line.
That line, if it's moving in a circle and then you remove the force, so again, that force which is going to be acting on it, we're going to see these sparks fly off in a straight line. So tangent. So you can see the motion of the circle, but now watch where the sparks are flying, right? Watch their path as they move. Watch the sparks.
This is a great demonstration for showing that if something's moving in a circle and you remove the centripetal force, it'll move in a straight line.
Now, what's great about this demonstration, I'll run it slow here, is if you watch the sparks, right? The sparks right here, you can tell this is a straight line and you can see exactly where on the circle it came from. So you remove the force and it's gonna fly off in a straight line. Same thing here, remove the force, straight line. You can see all of these sparks are tangent to the circle. Now, as we look at our velocity here, again, where is it coming from? How do we determine this? How do we calculate it? Our displacement for velocity is going to be based on the circumference of the circle. Think way back about base definition of velocity. It's your displacement over your time. Well, now, since the object is moving in a circle, the displacement is going to be the circumference of the circle, which is going to be a really hard thing to measure. Think about both of the video clips that we just saw here for the hammer thrower and for the sparklers. It's very difficult to measure what that circumference is, but it would be easy to measure, say, the length of the chain of the hammer or how long that sparkler was, which is going to be used to then map out that circle. So the radius is going to be a helpful piece of information here. And then our other one, as we look at time, is going to be the period rather than the overall amount of time. It's going to be beneficial to know the overall amount of time, but then how many cycles it completed in that amount of time. So we're going to use the period. And the reason behind that is the circular motion is going to be uniform more often than not. Right? So we're going to have this nice uniform motion. It's going to be great. So it's going to take, in theory, the same amount of time to go around each revolution, as long as the same characteristics are staying true, which would be how much force is being applied to it, how fast, what the tangential velocity is. If those are staying consistent, then the time period it takes to go around once is going to be the exact same regardless of how many times it goes through. So the period is how long it takes the object to complete one full revolution. So this is time per cycle, or time per revolution is what we could call here. And because this is a definitive time period, it's going to be a capital T instead of a lowercase t. So if you watch the simulation in the bottom right here, you're going to see this object moving in circular motion. So here, each one of those times around is going to be the exact same amount of time, which means if you counted the total number of revolutions and you counted the total amount of time for those revolutions, you would take the time for all of them divided by the number of revolutions is how we would get our period. Numerically, what ends up happening then for our velocity is we put a little subscript t there to represent tangential or our linear velocity, and then it's just a little bit of substitution. So because our velocity is our change in position delta x over our change in time delta t, we're able to bring in the circumference and the period respectively. So for our delta x, the displacement, now the displacement is going to be the circumference of that circle, which is defined as 2 pi r, right? 2 times pi times the radius of the circle. That's going to be our circumference. Our period, rather than being delta t, is now going to be capital T, which again represents our period. It's how long per cycle, how long for each individual revolution. So we're still delta x over delta t. It just looks a little bit different. So if we look at a quick example here, you get on a ride at an amusement park that spins in a perfect circle with a top linear speed of 22 meters per second. When at top speed, the ride completes 10 revolutions in 30 seconds. What is the radius of the ride? Information that we know right away. We know that this is a perfectly circular ride. So we're gonna get our circle. And we know that this thing completes 10 revolutions in 30 seconds, and we know its top linear speed is 22 seconds. Based on that, our variables that we know are the tangential velocity of 22 meters per second. We know the number of revolutions at top speed is 10. And we know our time of those 10 revolutions is 30 seconds. Our base formula that we're going to want to use here is going to be the period and then into our tangential velocity. Because if you notice here, V of t is 2 pi r over the period. We know the information for the period, but we don't know exactly what it is. So we're going to take a little side spin, and we're going to look at the period, which is going to be our time per revolution. So our time period, is going to be 30 seconds per 10 revolutions or 10 cycles to get us a period of 3 seconds. So it takes 3 seconds if we start at the top of the circle here to go from the beginning of that circle all the way around and back is going to take 3 seconds. Thus, why 10 cycles takes 30 total seconds to get around. Using that time period and using our tangential velocity, we're going to rewrite this formula to solve for our radius. So we're going to be our tangential velocity times our period divided by 2 pi. In order to solve this, now we're just plug and chug. So we're 22 meters per second at 3 seconds for our time period divided by 2 pi. And when you plug that into your calculator, you end up getting 10.5 meters, which, to put that into perspective for you for this radius, that's going to be a little more than 30 feet. And on the diagram, that's going to go from the edge out to the center. That's going to be our radius. So this entire ride, and if you think about an amusement park ride, it's going to be more than 60 feet for a diameter, which is going to be very, very large. But this problem right here gives you a pretty good look at how we're going to use our tangential velocity formula right here, while also giving you a little side note on how we can solve for the period when we're given enough information. So to conclude the video lesson here, things that you gotta remember, that the tangential velocity, right, it is a linear velocity, even though the object is moving in a circle. And that is because we have something pulling on that object, which is causing it to move in a circle. And when that force is removed, we move in a straight line. We recognize that our displacement is the circumference of the circle, and that our time around the circle is really going to be represented by the period, because that circular motion is going to be nice and uniform.